All right. So tonight we're gonna do a little bit different. We're gonna still go through with the study, but you know this last 8 months of my life, obviously it's been a crazy journey. Just like I'm sure a lot of you guys have experienced the same thing. There's different chapters in our lives that we go through, these trials and tribulations, so God can work out His eternal purpose in our life. Our deal is we couldn't get pregnant for the life of us. My wife, you know, tried for a year and a half, couldn't do it, and finally we got pregnant, right? And we got pregnant with the triplets, and basically through that journey, it's been a crazy journey. But you know, like the study tonight, it's gonna be called Living the Impossible, and it's basically this journey that we've been on with the triplets. We've been living the impossible. And I'm gonna go into a little bit more detail about the story in a second after we play a little bit of this song here. But during this whole season, Lacey Sturm came out with a song called Impossible. And the chorus in it's called Living the Impossible. And when I listen to it, I'm like, oh my gosh, this is like the theme. You know when there's these songs that come out, or like a worship song you listen to, there's like certain songs you listen to in times of your life, and you're like, this is like the theme song of my life right now. And this song is basically talking about, you know, living the impossible. And we live the impossible through Jesus Christ, because things that are impossible for us, we're like, there's no way we can do this. There's no way we can do it. But with God, we know we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, right? So this song, you know, I've never done this before, but we're gonna play a whole song. It's 3 minutes and it's a little rowdy. So, you know, if you're a newcomer here, it's about to get crazy for a minute. She's a rock artist. She was the lead singer of a band called Flyleaf, and they were in the mainstream. They went platinum, you know, sold millions of records. We've worked with them. She was one of the original founders of the Whosoever's movie that came alongside when I started it. And then she started to have kids, so she left the band, took some time off. She started doing a lot of stuff with the Billy Graham Association. We've had her here many times. She does killer worship as well. But then God called her back to go back into the world and be that light in the world. So now she went out and they were shopping her album. And basically what happened is, you know, Interscope Records wanted to sign her and a bunch of other labels wanted to sign her. And they wanted to, you know, like all record labels do is they steal from you. You know, they basically take all your money. They say, oh, we're gonna give you a record deal. Then they basically jack all your money and put you on tour and make you work for like 15 grand a year for the rest of your life, you know, touring every day away from your family. Totally jack you. So she says, you know, I don't feel like that's God's deal. I'm gonna do this album and put it out, and we're gonna just put it out and see what happens. Well, it turns out she, on Billboard mainstream music charts, when she dropped her album Impossible, or the single is called Impossible, when she dropped it, she became the first solo female artist ever to hit the rock charts. Hit the rock charts. God's blessing on this woman. It went to number one. It went to number one in the rock music chart, mainstream, and it's all about God, obviously. And not only that, now it's in the top 20 because there's new songs that come out all the time. But it's staying in the top 20, which is insane. So now when the song came out, I started listening to it. I'm like, oh my gosh. This is like not only the theme of this last 8 weeks, but it's the theme of since I got saved. We're always living the impossible. We're coming out of the darkness into the light. Some of you guys are coming out of addiction into the light and you think it is impossible. No, it is possible through Christ. Maybe you're coming from a marriage that is broken, or maybe there's stuff going on like our radio show last night. You know, Cynthia was in a marriage that was falling apart. She says it was impossible. There's no way that God can restore it. But God, through Jesus Christ, everything is possible. So this song I want to play for you, it's like 3 minutes. Enjoy it. It's rock. So if you're kind of a little loud, or not a little loud, but a little too crazy, you could just do earmuffs. But check it out. Listen to the lyrics. I have the lyrics up for you guys, so you could actually watch them.
Myself soaring higher. I'm pouring out like I am endless.
That album now. So check this out. 34 weeks ago, 34 weeks ago, my wife couldn't get pregnant, and we couldn't make it happen. And God ended up working those details out. We got pregnant with triplets, and they said, if you can just get through the first trimester, which is the first 3 months, you're going to be good. We get to the first 3 months, 16 weeks out, and they said, hey, these kids want to come out. We don't think it's going to happen. You're going to lose these kids. And literally, we were like, this is crazy. Our world's gonna fall apart. We're gonna lose these three kids. You know, how is this gonna happen? And literally, we just started praying. And we are praying for one day at a time, 1 week at a time. And I remember our doctors, they're Christians. Him and his wife were in there, and his wife, when she heard the news and the situation, what was going on, she started crying. You know it's bad when the doctor's wife that works with you starts crying. You know what I mean? And they're Christians, so they were like heartbroken, like, oh my gosh. And we all got together in that room, and we all held hands, the doctor, the wife, her, my wife, and we all held hands, and we started praying and calling out to God, saying, God, give us
26 weeks. That means the babies could come out and live, and they could have problems, but they could live.
Give us 26 weeks, God. And we were praying and praying. And the fact that we got there, and another thing too, is right when we found out that at 16 weeks, when we found out right at the trimester that we were gonna lose them,
We didn't know if we were going to be able to keep them. We were praying. You know, we said, yeah, we prayed. And we said, God, get us to the 26th so they could come out alive. And when my mom heard what happened, obviously we were all here. We were all praying. My mom was praying to God, talking to God. Because remember, God, we talk to God, we pray to God, and he talks back to us. And my mom was praying every night. And she's like, God, she's like, please show me, speak to me, give me a verse, give me a dream, give me a vision, give me something to show me about these kids. Because right now, this is just completely crazy. And when she was praying, she woke up in the middle of the night, and she had like this, it was like a dream or a vision. I think it was like a picture. It was basically a picture. And what she saw, I might have shared this with you. This is at 26 weeks. She had a vision that she saw a huge sea, a raging river, an ocean, like a sea, just completely in chaos. And she saw like a hand. She's looking down in this vision, and she saw a hand from here down coming out. And the hand was basically God's hand, but the arm was God's arm, and the hand of it formed into a fishing boat. And in that boat, one of there's triplets. So there's two identicals, and then there's the other one, the fraternal. So the fraternal one, Sadie, basically was like, she was inside standing up like this. So her hands were like on the thumb looking out, looking. She was looking out. And I don't even know what she's going to look like, but this is what she looked like there. So we'll see if the, you know, she looks the same. She had like brown hair, short brown hair, and like bluish eyes or something. And she was kind of like lighter skin. So she must have got my mom's skin. Lighter skin. And she was looking out, and she was holding the thumb, and she was just like, she wasn't scared. And there was a raging storm, crazy, and she was just looking out. And then you had the two identical twins underneath her, and they were like kind of hiding, like staying close to their sister, like hiding under the thumb. And what my mom said is, she says, I see what God kind of spoke to me is that these babies are in a storm, but God's in full control. They're resting in God's hand. And this was 26 weeks out. So we were like, okay, God, you're in complete control. We know the story of when Jesus walked on the water and the disciples were there. We know that story. So what's interesting about this, I said, okay, God, then we trust in you, and we know that you're in complete control because you're in control over the elements. You spoke the heavens and the earth. Can you not hold three babies in a womb? Are you kidding me right now? You're the one knitting them together. You're the one that's giving them the personality. You're the one that knows how many hairs are on their head. Is it so? I feel like it was like, Ryan, can I not just keep them in? Come on, man. Give me a break. But what's interesting is that during this time that this is happening, I even had another friend of ours, the wife of the guy that works with me. She had a dream that Crystal had a huge belly. She had a dream. She called up a week later and said, hey, I had this dream. And Crystal had this huge belly. And this is all encouragement during these times. Because right now, Crystal didn't even have a belly at the time. You know, we're talking about the kids maybe coming out. And so we got these encouraging things while this was happening. But what's so interesting about the whole thing is that when I got saved, I remember this story. It's so ironic. When I first got saved, I remember hearing this story about Jesus walking on the water. And I said, what a stupid story. I hate that story. Who would even believe? Because I'm new. I'm fresh out of the world trying to know about Jesus. And I'm hearing this story about Jesus walking on water. I'm like, that is such a dumb story to have in the Bible. Like, I could see, like, he made food for the people. He healed people. But him walking on the water, the storm of the boat, I don't even get it. But what's so crazy about this whole situation, how the timing is so on point, how God is so point, how God is omniscient. He's out of time and space. He created time and space. He's in time and space as far as he's in the beginning of time to the end of time, but he's outside because he created time. He is so precise on Bible prophecies. He's so precise on the Bible stories. He's so precise on things that happen in our life that the fact that I'm here standing before you when I was going through a storm in my life, when we got this pregnancy, and then God speaks to my mom through a dream or a vision, whatever it was, about this story of the storm and how I refer to, the first thing that brought to my memory was Jesus walking on the water, that stupid story I used to think. But after I studied it, I realized I loved it, right? So now God's using this story, the one that stood out of all of them, and the situation that's in my life, to me being here now with you, that I've been teaching John for over a year now, just going one story at a time, for me here standing before you guys tonight at Shine, that this is the last Bible study I'm going to have now because the kids are coming basically this week, this Friday, but next week is going to be the Harvest America, which is going to be here on Sunday. So technically speaking, for sure, this is my last study before the kids come. And what's so stinking interesting about the whole thing is that the story that we are now at in the Gospel of John, not by timing or anything, is Jesus walking on water. Is that insane? So go ahead and turn to John chapter 6. You couldn't have timed that. You couldn't have timed that. You know what Jesus is doing? He's just smiling. He's laughing. He's like, I told you, what's up? What up? What up, Ryan? Oh, you with little faith, like he told Peter. You with little faith. I'm like, I know, God, I know. Trying to get it together, man. I'm a disciple, man. I'm trying to figure it out. But the timing of it is amazing. And here we are in John chapter 6, verse 16. Now, this is the catch. This story, it's not this story. It's the feeding of the 5,000. But this story in John chapter 6, verse 16, it's too short. They just give a quick overview. So I'm going to teach the lesson in Matthew because it has a longer version. But I'm going to just read through this really quick. And then we're going to flip over to Mark and I'm going to teach it through there. So it goes on like this. That evening, the evening after, you know, Jesus fed the 5,000. That evening, Jesus' disciples went down to the shore to wait for him. But a darkness fell and Jesus still hadn't come back. They got into the boat and headed across the lake towards Capernaum. Soon a gale swept down above them and the sea grew very rough. They had rowed 3 or 4 miles and when suddenly they saw Jesus walking on water towards the boat. They are terrified. But he called out to them and said, "Don't be afraid, I am here." Then they were eager to let him into the boat and immediately they arrived at their destination. Now I'm going to flip over. You guys can flip over to Matthew chapter 14, verse 22. So now I'm going to break down exactly what happened. Since we're going through the Gospel of John, I wanted to read that. And Lord, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that your Holy Ghost power will be carried out here tonight, Father. Light me on fire and let me burn for you, Father God. Let my words, whatever you have me say, let my words penetrate the hearts of those that have come here looking for something, Lord. And what they're looking for is you. Those ones that have come in here to hear a word, help me to just teach us very simply, but the heart of your heart, God, the way you look at your people, the way you feel towards your people, Lord. Just take control of this night. I pray for the people that are maybe struggling with life and life issues, that you will draw them by your Spirit and do that supernatural work of the Holy Spirit, that work that draws people to themselves, and then they will accept you as their Lord and their Savior, God, and then they can have this relationship that I have and many people have here, Lord, how they can speak to you and you will speak back, and how through prayer, things happen, Lord, through prayer, and how you're so precise on situations in life. We know that all things work together for good for those that love you according to your purpose. All things work together for the good for those who love you, that the works are according to your purpose, God. So God, carry out your will and draw those that need to come home to you, that need to come into a relationship with the God of the universe, the one that created all things, not religion. Religion's a waste, God. Jesus, you were against religion. You were about a personal relationship and a love relationship. And our relationship is a day-by-day relationship. We grow day by day. We fail day by day, but we learn. We learn who you are. We learn about your grace, and we learn about the purpose, why you created us, Lord. And it's day by day, and it's so simple. And I thank you, Lord, for people, for making it so easy for people like me, because I'm stubborn, I'm hard-headed, I don't get it all the time. I'm like the disciples. It's like I need it put in my face 100 times, Lord, before I get it. So thank you for being gracious for people like me that don't connect the dots all the time. So, Lord, thank you for what you're going to do here tonight. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. So here we go. Matthew 14, verse 22. Immediately after this, immediately after what? Last week we talked about Jesus fed the 5,000 plus the women and children. So there could have been anywhere from 12,000 people to 20,000 people or 15,000 people. We said if you go to the Staples Center, that fits 20,000 people. So all these people came to Jesus, and now Jesus' disciples have been with them for 2 years. And Jesus has been doing signs and wonders. He's been teaching with authority. We know that they've had hard-hearted and they can't connect the dots, but Jesus is doing all these miracle signs. He does this huge miracle where he feeds with five loaves of bread and two fish. He feeds up to 20,000 people in front of them. Okay, and as these herded people are coming, Jesus sees them and he tells Philip, he goes, hey, dude, how are we going to feed them? And Philip's like, we can't feed all these people. Even if we worked, all 12 of the disciples and you, Jesus, we worked for months. We couldn't feed all these people. And not only that, there was no stores around there. It's like desolate land, even when you go there today. But Philip got his eyes on the temporal situation, the problem, instead of realizing, dude, I'm with God. He should have been like, Jesus, see these stones? Be God and do God stuff. Make all this bread out of here. Make wine come out of make water or wine come out of the rock like Moses made the water come out. I mean, do whatever you want to do, Jesus. But he got his eyes off the fact that he wasn't with God and that God was with him. Then Peter's brother steps up and goes, oh, man, hey, there's a kid right there that has five loaves of bread and two fish. So his faith stepped up. But then he was like, but we can't do it, right? So what happens is Jesus goes, okay, just get everyone together, puts them in 50s and puts them all together. And he basically gets the stuff. He blesses it with what little he has, gives it to God, blesses it, and then God multiplies it. And they feed all these people. So now after this miracle, and not only that, the disciples got to take away 12 baskets each full. So they started off with five loaves and two fish. And now each basket, because all the leftovers of after feeding 20,000 people, they all had a basket. So if the disciples were still hard-hearted and they weren't getting it, they weren't connecting the dots, now they're walking away with this basket and Jesus is kind of rubbing it in like, I'm God. Hey, do you notice like you're heavy, you're carrying this thing, I'm God. Okay, get it. So after this happened, immediately, Jesus insisted that the disciples get back into the boat and cross to the other side of the lake while he sent the people home. So now here's Jesus after this miracle. He's sending all 15 to 20,000 people home, give them a hug, give them a high five, whatever they did back then, give them a little side cheek, hey, talk to you guys later, I'll see you guys later. But you disciples, you need to get in the boat and you need to go on the other side of the lake. So I thought, why in the heck would Jesus immediately tell these guys to just get on the other side? I think because they just had a mountaintop experience. God just manifested his power pretty heavily to feed 20,000 people, 15 to 20,000 people. So he sends them on the boat to maybe, sit there. They have the 12 baskets. They're probably sitting on the boat with the 12 baskets kind of like tripping on each other, just going like, dude, what just went down? And how does that not happen when God does something radical? You pray for someone gets healed, or you've been praying for someone for like 100 years and then all of a sudden they get saved. What a miracle is that, right? Dude, for someone to come out of the darkness, to like come out of their old life, no matter what, and I don't care if you're a rich millionaire and you got tons of money and you don't use drugs or anything, but you're walking away from God, you have no desire to be with God, when you come out of that lifestyle and you enter into light, into Jesus, that is a miracle. Because it's impossible. Jesus gave this demonstration. He says, it's hard. It's easier for a hard man to go through an eye of a needle than for him to enter the kingdom of God. And his disciples were tripping on him going, Jesus, what? Then who can be saved? And he says, with man, it's impossible, but with God, all things are possible. All things are possible. So it's a supernatural miracle. So these guys saw this miracle. They're probably sitting there, talking like, dude, what just went down? Can you believe that Jesus just did that?
He is the God. He is God, for sure. Yeah, oh yeah, bro, for sure. He's God, right? Yeah. Did you see that? You have to be God. You know, they're by themselves now. You know when you're like, you know, Jesus is out there doing his thing, and now they're all talking by themselves, like, well, I didn't think he was, but, you know, after seeing all this stuff, today, he's definitely God. I mean, look at all these things. And, you know, they're out there talking, chopping it up, talking about this mountaintop experience, probably reflecting back on the last 2 years of ministry they've been with them, kind of trying to connect the dots. Because we know that they had hard hearts. That's what it says in Matthew, right? So maybe their hearts are starting to get soft, but I also know that Jesus had them go out there because he's going to test their faith. And how often is it for us that what happens? God does a work in our life that it strengthens our faith, right? And then what does God want to do later on? He puts us to the test. Why does he put us to the test? Because he wants our roots to grow deep. He wants our faith to grow. So he'll teach us a lesson, and then he'll give us a little pop quiz, right? And that's how our testing, our faith keeps enduring. That's why when this whole thing happened with the triplets, I was like, oh my gosh, one side of me, I'm like, dude, this is so gnarly. Like, you know, the science is saying that these things are going to come out. I'm seeing the scan. Like, I'm looking at it going, the kids are going to come out. Like, I'm visually seeing that this can't happen. But then on the other side of me, I'm going, dude, God has done so many miracles in my life. My faith has been strengthened over just the last 9 years of what God's done in my life since I became a Christian. So my faith was there. Crystal was brand new. She's only been a Christian for two years, so she was new in the faith. So she's just kind of like, and I'm like, no. I'm all, dude, God is going to see us through. God's going to see us through. And if this is his will that he wants these babies, Dunskies. If not, they're going to heaven. Either way, we're gonna see these kids. We want his eternal purpose to work out. But my faith grew because of what God has done. So here they are. They're going across the lake. Who knows what they're talking about? Probably just talking about what just happened. After sending them home, Jesus sent the people home. He went up into the hills by himself to pray. Night fell while he was there alone. So now, after Jesus does this miracle, huge miracle, he's been going around teaching people. He's basically casting out demons. He's healing the sick, making the blind see, making the deaf talk. He's doing all these miracles, but now he's also spending time with God the Father. He's plugged into the source. And you know how we've talked about, you know, it's important for us to read, to pray, to be plugged into the source, and how we talked about, you know, you get the iPhone and you plug it into the phone to the charger, and because it only has 10% and you leave, and then you come back and you realize it's still on 10% because it was plugged in, but it wasn't actually connected. You know, you plug it in, but it's not fully in to get the charge. Well, that's how a lot of us spend our life with God, is we get saved, we're on fire for God for a while, but then we stop connecting to the source. You come into church, you're here, but you're not here. You're like on your phone, and you're thinking about what you're gonna do after, what you gotta do tomorrow. You're plugged in, but you're not connected to the source. So what Jesus is doing is he's going to the Father God, and he's going, God, thy will be done. I did that miracle because I've seen you doing the miracle, so I'm doing that miracle. What are we doing next? And he's probably telling him, hey, you're going to go out, and you're going to go meet with the disciples, and you're going to give them their next test. You're going to the cross, son. I'm going to be with you. We commune with the Father. This is why this is important with prayer. Some of you guys going, what's so important with prayer? What is prayer? Prayer is talking to God. It's very important, prayer. So a couple of things to pray is you pray for your family, right? You pray for your kids so they don't get caught up and they walk away from the Lord, or they don't get caught up in sketchy situations. I mean, we live in the crazy culture these days, you guys. I hang out with high school kids all the time. And if you could hear the stuff that they're going through and the stuff that they're talking about, it's crazy. And if you think you're a parent going, my kids are all good, trust me, I don't think so. Be careful. I'm just saying, it's not what it appears, okay? My parents had no idea. My dad's Ries, you know, and I don't, I'm like, big deal. My dad's my dad, right? My dad's a pastor of this church. Dude, I was into crazy stuff, and my parents had no idea till later on in life. Gnarly stuff, very young age. When they run around, when I was with my friends, I'd show up at my friend's house, and you would see, I'd go to my friend's house, and his dad supplied him with every Penthouse and Playboy magazine. I'm in fourth grade. You know, when you're a young kid, mischievous, you want to get into that stuff, you're like, jackpot, you know what I'm saying? But that stuff jacks your mind up. That stuff jacks you up so bad. And my parents didn't know that. Because you see stuff at your
their friend's house. You see stuff on TV, you get exposed to stuff. So pray for your family. This is my favorite one. Pray for forgiveness. Oh man, I need that, right? I need forgiveness. And this is what opens the doorway to the spirit realm. This opens the wide pearly gates to heaven, to the throne of God, when you ask for forgiveness. Because if you're sinning, you're asking for forgiveness, and you're praying, it's not connecting. It's not making it there. You have to literally ask for forgiveness, and that makes that connection, that power source. Like that monster cable, when you hook up a sound system in your car, you get that monster cable. You know what I'm saying? You'll get that cheap, that little thin one, of you guys that know about sound. You get that gold monster cable with the gold connection, so you get that pure power, right? So you got to pray for forgiveness. Pray for God's will to be worked out in your life. Pray for direction in your life. What does he want you to do? You know, that one Proverbs, my favorite proverb says, you know, man makes the plans, but God directs his steps. We pray, God, no matter, even if I make plans, maybe they're not the right plans because I'm Ryan and I do dumb things, you know? Direct my steps, please, and I pray for that. So God will close the doors he doesn't want me to go through. Pray for your marriage, so important. Like I said last night, our friend Cynthia was on there talking about marriage, how she was about to lose it. It was falling apart. She thought it was over. But she prayed, and the power of God worked out, and he basically had his will, and he restored her marriage, and they had kids, and he brought it all together. And now, you know, they don't have the perfect family, but Satan wants to destroy. He wants to pull marriages apart. He wants people to think, oh, the grass is greener on their side. Oh, it's going to be good. I have friends that have been married 3 times, and they said it's never greener on their side. I have another friend that's, I think, has been divorced like 4 times, one of my friend's mom. And you know what? It's never greener. She's actually divorced again. Because why? You think, oh, this person's perfect. It's going to be way better. Guess what? That person has issues. Just like your husband, just like your wife, but it's through Jesus Christ that God works out his eternal purpose, and he works out his grace, and he works out. He just puts it together, and he helps us get through those hard times. It's never greener on the other side. So we got to pray for that. We need to pray for peace and joy as well, because there's no peace that you can have that the world can offer you. It's only through the peace through Jesus Christ. You could go out and buy that nice car. You could get that nice house. You could buy everything you possibly want, and that stuff will give you no peace. And I know everyone can relate to that. You know, you could get that car. You know, someone, if you ever dreamed of getting a 7 Series BMW and you got the rims, you got the whole thing, and you get it, and then what happens? Someone like accidentally like has some key thing hanging and walks by and scratches your car. Now you're bummed out. Or you get it and you accidentally turn and you hit a pole. Boom, front end gone. Now your joy is gone. That doesn't even give you joy. It gives you happiness. Your joy is gone. And the only way you can have joy, even through the crazy things in our life, is through Jesus Christ. This is why prayer is so important. Going on, it says this. And let me actually read you a couple things what it says about prayer in Philippians 4, 6 through 7. It says this about prayer. It kind of backs up what I just said, actually. It says this. It says, don't worry about anything. Or in another translation, King James says, don't be anxious for nothing. I like anxious because I get anxious. These kids make me anxious right now. They're not even here yet, right? Life makes me anxious. People make me anxious sometimes, right? Anxious. Don't be anxious about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Then it goes on to say, tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace. How are you going to experience God's peace? Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace by praying about everything. Then it goes on to say this. It says, then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds everything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. How will his peace guard your hearts and mind? As you live and you abide in a relationship with Jesus Christ. 2 Thessalonians says, pray without ceasing. That means pray without ceasing, never stopping. I'm in the shower and I pray out loud, and my wife will walk in and be like, you know, I'm talking to God. I'm praying to God. You know, I'm praying to God in my car. I'm talking out loud. I,
I pray wherever I'm at, if I see someone, some guy talking to himself, and you know, he's talking to someone else actually, probably a demon or something, I start praying for that guy. Wherever I'm at, I'm always constantly praying that God will work out his eternal purpose in my life. What's the other thing in Galatians it says about praying? In Galatians 3:3, it says this. It says, Galatians 3:3 says, you receive the Holy Spirit because you believe the message you have heard about Jesus. How foolish can you be after starting your new lives in the Spirit? Why are you trying to become perfect in your own human effort? He's basically in the King James Version, it says, oh, you foolish Galatians, you started out in the work of the Spirit, and now you're trying to perfect yourself in the works of the flesh. And a lot of us, like I said earlier, you give your life to God, you start walking with God, you're praying, you're going to study 6 days a week, you're reading the Bible, you're like hungry, and then what happens? You know, you meet a girl, you meet a guy, oh, let's not go to church tonight, you know, or the football season's on, or the basketball season, or this or that, you make some other excuse, I gotta clean the garage, and then you miss church 1 week, then you miss church another week, you don't pray as much, and what happens is then you're trying to work out your faith through the work of the body appetites or your flesh or the work of the flesh, basically, what you're trying to do. You're trying to be perfected, live for God through your flesh. But we know that that's not true. We can't do it. We have to be prayed up. We have to read the Bible. We have to be plugged into the source. And Jesus is the perfect example. He's living out the purpose why God sent him to the earth, to die on the cross and to teach the disciples about who he is and to heal people. And he's still staying plugged into the source, praying to God the Father for direction. Verse 24, it says this, meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from the land. From a strong wind has risen and they were fighting the heavy waves. So we know in that area of the Galilee, when you go out there this year with us, basically, the Galilee is 600 feet below sea level. What happens is the heat rises up and then the coastal air will come over the mountains. And when they mix, you get a wind effect like over here in the Banning Pass or like Palm Springs. You know, you have the big windmills out there. Like, you know, I think the big fans, I don't know what they're called. But those things to create energy. It's super windy. So what happens now is this huge windstorm kicked up. And now with that windstorm, if any of you guys surf, you know when you can get like a wind swell, just from wind, and it can create waves. And when those waves that it would create out there in the Sea of Galilee, it could be up to 7 to 12 feet swells. And the Sea of Galilee, it looks like it's just a huge giant lake. They call it a sea, but it's a huge giant lake. So you have 7 to 10 foot swells going on. You got these seamen, they're fishermen in the middle of the sea. It's super windy. And you know, when there's like offshore winds and the waves are breaking, you know, the wind blows the water, so you can't really see. It gets kind of foggy. There's wind. It's at night. It's a full moon. It's crazy out there, right? So about 3:00 in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on water. When the disciples saw him walking on water, they were terrified in fear. They cried out, "It's a ghost." I'm going to tell you right now, these dudes were tired. They've been working. Imagine serving 12 to 20,000 people food and fish and talking to them, accommodating them, helping Jesus, working all day. They're tired. You know, now they're out in the middle of the sea. Huge waves kick up. They're getting tossed to and fro. It's a full moon, you know. It's windy. It's crazy. And all of a sudden, they see a man walking on water. Dude, I would be terrified. I would be tripping if I was these guys. Think about that, a dude hanging out on the water, right? So now what happens is basically in verse 27, it says this, but Jesus spoke to them at once. He said, "Don't be afraid," he said. "Take courage, I'm here." And I love this verse because Jesus is omniscient. He's everywhere. This is a verse that you guys could circle, write down, and hold to your heart. No matter what you're going through in your life, do not be afraid. Take courage. Jesus is always with them. So he calls them out and says that to them. Verse 28, it goes on to say this. Then Peter called him. He said, "Lord," which remember, Lord is a title. When we call Jesus Christ our Lord, that means that he is God. He reigns over everything. He is number one. We're not putting anything in front of God. He is our Lord. He's basically saying, "Jesus, if that's you, Lord, God, Messiah, chosen one, God, creator over all things, if that's you," I love Peter, because if that's you, if that's really you, "tell me to come to you." tell me to come walking on water. He's basically saying, okay, God, if that's you walking on water, if that's you out there, you have to be God. You're God over the elements. You're walking on water. Tell me to come out to you. I'm trying to be where you're at, God. If you're out there walking on God water, doing God stuff, then call me and I'm going to come walking on water. I'm going to come out of the boat. I'm in here with these 11 other disciples. And these guys are still terrified. And I love Peter, how he stands up and he's like, you know, everyone else is not saying anything. They're terrified. They're saying it's a ghost. But Peter stands up out of the boat. He can't tell if it's Jesus or not. But he's like, if that's you and that's God, I'm going to come out there. And I want to walk on water to you. I mean, that's completely insane for Peter to do. So then in verse 29, it says this. Jesus said, yes, come, Jesus said. So Peter went out on the side of the boat, walking on water towards Jesus. Why in the heck is Peter walking on water right now? This is insane. There's a man walking on water in the middle of a storm out of a boat. A human man, not God. Jesus is God. He's walking on water. I could deal with that. Why in the heck is Peter, a man, walking on water right now? Who does that? Well, this is the deal. Peter's walking on water because he called out to God and said, hey, God, if that's you, then tell me to come to you walking on water. And Jesus said, yes, come. And that goes for you guys. If any of you guys call out to Jesus and say, Jesus, if you want me to go out and be a missionary in Africa, then call me. And if Jesus says, all right, he opens the doors, he talks to you, speaks to you audibly or speaks to you through the word, and he calls you, guess what? You're going to be a missionary in Africa. Peter's walking on water because he called out to Jesus. If that's you, have me walk on water. He said, yes, come. If you ask Jesus something and he says yes, you're going to do it. That's why Peter's walking on water. The fact when God called me to come out and start speaking, I'm like, God, I can't do that. And he's like, basically like, I'm calling you to come out. I said, all right, I'm going to walk. And the fact that I'm up here teaching now is because Jesus said, yes, come. Therefore, this is why I'm speaking. Same thing with the radio. I said, dude, God, if you want me to do that radio show, you open the door. God opened up radio show for 42 stations free across the United States in 13 different states. Why? Because Jesus said, yes, come. And I went, and guess what? I'm doing a radio show across the United States for free because Jesus said, yes, come. And this is the way it works. This is not about me. The point is, Peter is living the impossible. Homie is walking on water. And a lot of us can live the impossible, but the problem is a lot of us say, Jesus, call me and I'll come. But the problem is when you're praying this or you're talking to God, you say that and he calls you and he opens the door, but you don't come. And you're able to walk, maybe not walk on water, but you're going to walk whatever he's called you to do. And there's a lot of people that are missing out, living the impossible, because they're too scared to stink and jump out of the boat. And the boat could be this church right here. There's people in this boat, this church right here, that God has called and said, hey, yes, come, step out of the boat. And I'm one of them, and I know a lot of people personally that have done that. But there's a lot of people that are in this boat that Jesus is saying, come, step out of the boat. I want to show you what living the impossible is all about. Living the impossible is basically living out the purpose for why you were created. When Jesus knit you together in your mother's womb, like it says in Psalms, he knit you together with a purpose and a plan. He designed you for a specific plan and a purpose on this earth. But the problem is so many of us get caught, stuck in the boat. And a lot of those disciples, they hung out with Jesus. They heard the stories. They heard the teaching. They saw the miracles. They heard the Bible studies. They were personally with Jesus for 2 years, but they were scared and they didn't step out of the boat. And that could be any of us here. And we all got to do inventory in our life. The whole thing, you guys, it's living the impossible. And how we can do that is we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us and created us. We have to live out the purpose why we were created. So here you have Peter stepping out of the boat,
walking on water. What a crazy, crazy story, but how beautiful this story is. I used to be annoyed with this story. But it's such a beautiful thing to me right now in this time of my life. We've been walking on water, basically. This whole pregnancy, this whole adventure, we stepped out the boat and we go, we're gonna believe you, Jesus. We're gonna believe who you say you are, and we're gonna walk by faith. And this is so relatable, what happens to Peter, because this could happen to all of us. And it does happen to us, because we have lapses of faith. So here it goes on, and we're gonna be closing here shortly. It says this. So Peter walked on water, but when he saw the strong wind and the waves, he was terrified and he began to sink. And when I saw what happened, when we saw the scan of what was going on, I was walking my walk in faith towards God. I was doing what God called me to do, but then I saw the scan and I had a lapse of faith. I started seeing what was going on. And a lot of us, maybe you're looking at circumstances that are happening in your life right now. You're getting your eyes off of Jesus. You call yourself a Christian, but you're not looking at who Jesus says he is and who the Bible says he is. You're looking at your finances. You're looking at your family. You're looking at your job. You're looking at all these things that are falling apart and all the stuff that's happening. You know, maybe your son is backslidden. You know, whatever the situation that is going on in your life, you get your eyes off of Jesus. You start looking at the circumstances and your faith begins to sink. You start looking at the natural world, the world that we see right here in 3D, and you're getting your eyes off of the supernatural. The supernatural is God, and God is always working. He's working supernaturally in the natural world, behind the scenes, in another realm, in another dimension, in his realm. So he gets his eyes off of Jesus, he starts to sink, and he says, "Save me," he shouted. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. And I love that, because it's so true, no matter what you're going through, I don't care what you're going through in your life. If you need saving, remember what Jesus said. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Take courage. I'm here. And this is the shortest prayer that was ever said. Save me. And you might be in that situation right now where you're saying, Jesus, save me. Save my life. Save my wife. Save my family. Save my job. Save me from what is happening in my life. And I guarantee you that Jesus is going to immediately come in and he's going to grab you and he's going to take control of your life. And Jesus doesn't always work. You know, things don't always work out immediately. Like, oh man, I give my life to you tonight, Jesus. Why is this still messed up? Jesus is working out his eternal purpose in your life. I got in a situation with a family member like a while ago, and we kind of split ways a while ago, you know, and I was talking to God. I was praying to him. And I'm like, God, what's happening right now? And God spoke to me, and he basically spoke to me and basically said, like, it's going to be a few years before this happens. And I said, okay, because I know that he was working on his eternal purpose. And I look back at those 2 years that went by that I didn't have a chance to, I couldn't be involved with this family member for a while. God worked out his eternal purpose, and he brought it all back together now. And we're all good now. But if he had stuff going on in my life he had to work out, and he had stuff going on in that person's life that they had to work out, because it's more important that God works out his eternal purpose in our life than to be the genie in the Jesus in the genie and work out our temporal situation, a quick fix. He's like, I'm going to get to that. I'm going to deal with that, Ryan. I know what I'm doing. I kind of created everything. I'm going to work that out, but I got to do it my way because I know what's best for the big picture of life. And that's when Jesus, when you call to Jesus, you say, save me, he's going to start immediately saving you. I can tell you that. Some things are going to happen overnight. I got healed from drugs and alcohol overnight. 3 days, boom, gone. Never. The rest is history. I don't even think about it anymore. But then God had to work out my porn problem over 6 months. Then God had to work out, you know, like my cussing, he took that away fairly fast. Cigarettes, that took longer. You know, that was a hard one to quit. But through Christ, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But he saved me immediately. He planted his spirit in my life. I was saved. I got peace in my life. I got joy. But then he had to work out his eternal purpose, because if he would have came to me right out of the gates and said, hey, you're not going to sleep with chicks anymore. You're not going to do drugs. You're not going to smoke cigarettes. You're not going to do this. I'd be like, I'm done. Forget that. I can't do this. Jesus, you're crazy. But what he did in his sovereign grace, he saved me immediately. He wrote my name in the book of life. And then he worked out his eternal purpose, and here I am, I've arrived. No, I haven't arrived. Not at all, I'm not arrived. But he's cleaning me up one day at a time, day by day. So here he goes. And this is what he did with the disciples. Look at the disciples. These guys have lapses of faith over and over and over. And Jesus does a miracle, teaches them, and tests them. Over and over, just like he does with us. We're disciples, we're students. Jesus is the rabbi, he's the teacher. So he's teaching them. So what does he do? He saves them. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. And he says, you have so little faith. Pete, dog, what's up? No faith. What about the 15,000, Pete? What happened? You were walking on water. You said, call me and I'll come walking on water. I did it. You walked on water. No little, such little faith, Petey. What's up, man? Rocky? And then he goes on to say, Jesus said, why did you doubt me? And you know what? That hit home for me when I read this. When I thought about, when I think about things when I have a lapse of faith or whatever, why'd you doubt me? I'm sitting here, you guys. I'm sitting here at 34 weeks tomorrow. And Jesus is going, why'd you doubt me? Why would you doubt me? And in closing, he says this. When they climbed back on the boat, the wind stopped. Then the disciples worshiped him. You really are the Son of God, they exclaimed. Really, guys? Really? Dude, these disciples are killing me. You really are the Son of God. Ugh. I can relate to these guys. Verse 34, after they crossed the lake, they landed in I always mess that word up. How do you pronounce that? Gennesaret, what? Okay, well, I'm going to pass that one, okay? I can't read it, they can't read it, all right, whatever. After they had crossed the lake, they landed on the other side of the lake, and when the people recognized Jesus, the news of his arrival spread quickly throughout the whole area, and soon people were bringing all the sick to be healed. They begged him to let the sick touch at least the fringes of his robe, and all who touched him were healed. They were begging Jesus, just let the sick, just touch your robe. They don't have to touch you, Jesus. Just touch their shoelace. Just touch something, and they were healed. And in the same way, if you're here, all you need is a touch of Jesus in your life. That's it. You have to reach out, though. You need to reach out to Jesus because Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one could come to the Father God but through me. But he gave us free will. We choose to follow him or we choose to deny him. And I guarantee the life that you're living in right now, you just close your eyes for a minute and think about, if you're not a Christian and you're living this life, whatever's going on, no matter what, I don't care how much money you have, I don't care what you're doing, you don't have the joy of the Lord and you don't have peace when you go to bed. But what you have to do is you have to reach out to Jesus and say, Jesus, I believe that you died on the cross on the third day. I believe that you raised from the dead and I believe that my sins are forgiven because whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And when you call on the name of the Lord and say, Jesus, forgive me for my sins, of everything I've ever done, baptize me with your Holy Spirit. It says that God the Father and Jesus, they're going to write your name in the book of life. And that means that you start living for the reason why you were created. And you may be saying, Ryan, I messed up too many years of my life. What's God going to do with my life? You guys, 9 years ago, I was eating so much ecstasy and shooting up heroin and smoking crack and shooting coke and drinking alcohol since I was 15 years old and eating Xanax like Tic Tacs and using massive amounts of hallucinogenics, LSD, and stuff like that. I was gone. I could literally feel my brain. I've never shared this with you. I was literally feeling like my brain was being fried. I would take so much ecstasy that my brain would be numb for like 3 weeks at a time and still kept doing it. My liver was killing. My kidneys were killing from the amounts of alcohol I'd be drinking. I would be sore and my liver would be killing. Have you guys ever drank that much? Some of you guys have. I was literally killing myself. My parents don't even know that to the extent of it. But I was killing myself. My life was done. I didn't care if I lived or died. I knew in my mind, I already saw a picture of me ODing in a hotel room. And I ended up ODing and I came out of it by the grace of God. But what happened is I gave my life back to God. And I just started going day by day, reading the Bible, following Jesus, wherever he would take me. And God has restored the years that the canker worm had destroyed. And he's given me back The abortions I've been through with girls, two abortions. One was a set of twins, and one was a baby. One, my wife gets pregnant with triplets. I get all three back. How precise is God? How precise is God? For me to sit up here and me to say these things and you not believe, you're crazy. God is so precise. Everything I've ever done, I go to the doctors to get a checkup. When I first got saved, they said, dude, you're good. Kidneys, liver. I said, you go check that again. Check that again. Nothing. God has healed me. He's restored. I got the dream girl, and God has brought life. But God has this for you today. Stop wasting time. And I want to get really real right now, if that's even the way you say that. I don't even know if that's a word. I beg you, by the blood of Jesus Christ, don't play any more games. Don't play with eternity. Don't play with your life. Live out the impossible. Live out what you were created for. The world has absolutely nothing for you. I had the dream job, and people dream of what I did. And that was empty and miserable. Everything I've ever done, do concerts, involved in music, throwing art, working with athletes, musicians, all these things I did not want to let go. I let go, and now I'm working with like 100 times more people. I'm doing way more stuff than I ever have, still using the gift that God's given me, still working in the industry, the skate industry, the music industry, the art industry, still doing all this, plus add radio, plus teach the Bible about Jesus, pulling people out of the gates of hell and escorting them into heaven. I'm doing way more. Now I know why I was created, and God has that for you. Quit playing games. If you want that, I want to pray for you. And this is not religion. This isn't like, man, I don't know, man, I can't stop. I got cigarettes. I got some bud in the car, man. I just picked up a sack. You know, I just bought a whole case of Coronas. You know, look it. Come as you are. Come as you are. I'm not. Do you think Jesus is offended? He died on the cross. He came to die for you. He came to die for you. Jesus is not offended with your mouth. He's not offended with what you're looking at. He's not offended with the drugs. He's not offended if you're gay. He's not offended. He's not offended about nothing. He loves homosexuals. He loves drag queens. He loves drug addicts. He loves gangsters. He loves sinners. That's why he died for you. He's trying to kick it with you. He's trying to kick it with you. That's why he died. He wants to hang out with you. He loves you.